Kindly turn off your mic. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. My name is Imran Sardar. I'm a research analyst at the Institute of Regional Studies. On behalf of the President, IRS Ambassador Nadeem Riaz, and my colleagues, I welcome all the participants to this webinar on 5G technology and cybersecurity challenges. In the previous seminar on cybersecurity threats and Pakistan response, the panelists stress for effective cyber governance in Pakistan. Speakers also discuss in detail the cybersecurity threats that Pakistan was facing, such as economic disruption in digital currency, the concept of cyberbullying and cyber harassments. Also discuss Pakistan's existing capacity to deal with those challenges. In this webinar, we would be discussing 5G technology and its challenges. Generally, we think 5G technology in terms of speedier downloads. But there is much more beyond that speed improvement. Since it is an introductory session, our focus would be on learning the concept of 5G technology or 5G networks. How is it going to benefit Pakistan's information technology infrastructure? And secondly, what are the security challenges this technology is bringing with advancement in data transmission. To discuss, we have Ms. Mubeen Ashraf and Mr. Arza Khan with us. I welcome you once again. The format is very thank you. The format is very simple. Each speaker will be given 10 to 15 minutes for the presentation. Later on, we will take some questions from the participants. And that question and answer session will be wrapped up in 20 minutes. And I request all the participants to please type in your question in the chat box during this session. That can be entertained in the Q&A session. There is also a hand raise option. Those who want to ask verbally, they are welcome in the question answer session. So I start with Ms. Mubeen Ashraf. Let me introduce the speaker. Ms. Mubeen Ashraf is a non-resident cybersecurity researcher at Global Foundation for Cyber Studies and Research at Washington, D.C. She did her MPhil in Defense and Strategic Studies from Qaid-e-Azam University, Islamabad. She has participated as speaker at various occasions. She was a speaker in a panel discussion on cybersecurity outlook 2021. Which was a part of International Silk Road Summit. Also participated in Beyond Frontiers organized by Cyber Exchange Canada. Also participated in panel discussion on new trends in cyber warfare organized by Cyber Exchange, the same organization from Canada. Ms. Mubeen Ashraf holds many certificates of excellence to her credit. With this brief introduction, I request Ms. Mubeen to please proceed with your presentation. Over to you.
Thank you so much for such a warm introduction. And I personally thank IRS team and for having me on this session. So let's begin with the presentation first. So the topic of today's presentation, as already told by Mr. Imran Sardar, that it's 5G technology and cybersecurity challenges. So I would begin with a brief introduction of the global information infrastructure, and then we'll move towards 5G and then the security threats as decided. So basically, global information infrastructure has been in debate since 1990s, and there are several countries who have already outlined their vision. And they have showed concerns in that perspective. And it is basically the connection. Let me read it for you. It was started as information infrastructure and is defined as a shared, evolving, open, standardized, heterogeneous installed base. The notion was introduced in 1990, first as a political initiative, later more specific to information systems research. And then GII, that is Global Information Infrastructure, is the governments, businesses, communities, and individuals that can work together to create a global information infrastructure which links the world's telecommunication and computer networks together and would enable the transmission of every conceivable information and information application. And in that regard, currently, internet is the GII of this era. And moving towards the 5G thing. One more thing I want to add to this GII stuff is, from 1996, there have been certain initiatives taken by the United Nations bodies and different regional organizations with the aim to enhance certain things in the GII. And one of the initiatives that was taken in the early 90s, late 1990s, was the Global Information Infrastructure to Global Information Society. And the aim of these two things, like intermingling of these two things, was to promote dynamic competition, encourage private investment, defining an adaptable regulatory framework, and providing open access to networks, while ensuring universal provisions of and access to services, promoting equality of opportunity to the citizens, promoting diversity of content, including cultural and linguistic diversities, recognizing the necessity of worldwide cooperation with particular attention to less developed countries. Then comes the 5G. First, what 5G is. 5G is basically the fifth generation technology, and it's the next generation of wireless communications. It is expected to provide internet connections that are faster, more than 4G LTE. And I expect that all of the participants here are well versed of 3G, 4G, 4G LTE, and now, of course, you will be well versed of 5G too. And all of you have been using the cellular devices. Sorry. For so long, and you have been gifted certain good speeds, internet speeds, to carry out many activities. So it is expected to provide internet connections as same as 4G LTE. 5G technology may use a variety of spectrum bands, including millimeter wave radio spectrum, which can carry very large amount of data and in a short distance, actually. The drawback of the higher frequencies is that they're more easily obstructed by the walls of buildings, trees, and other foliage, and inclement weather. This particular statement was meant to be discussed at the end, but I have purposely discussed it in the beginning to let us all know that with all of the advantages that every one of us knows about 5G, we are here to discuss about the severe challenges we'll be facing, and we are already facing, and we are not even realizing it. So the next point that I want to make is why there is a need for 5G. So many research papers have been written on that, and several authors have discussed that 5G network can provide more facilities, approach to common man to utilize his available possessions in an enormous way to make him feel the real progress. As per user's point of view, the major difference between current generations and expected 5G techniques must be something else than increased maximum throughout others. And other requirements include faster than 4G, lower latency, lower battery consumptions, lower outage probability, higher data transfer rates, more security, SDR security, better cognitive radio, full multimedia capability beyond 4G speeds, more application combines with artificial intelligence. Smart beam antenna systems. So 5G is next generation technology that will provide all the possible applications by using only one universal device and interconnecting most of already existing communication infrastructure. So we have several applications of 5G also, like in high speed mobile networks. I don't want to go into the details of it because we have a lot to cover. So I'll go through the limelights of the applications of 5G. And then entertainment and multimedia. Then the most important, while I was told that I have to talk on 5G, some of my friends who are actually practicing who are actually practicing cybersecurity, they were all concerned that 5G is so much related to IoT. And how are you going to explain this thing? Because it's a whole lot of technical stuff, and it's very important to discuss IoTs in it. And yes, I agree to that point that IoTs are an integral part of 5Gs. And with that, China aiming to have a digital CPEC, these things are going to happen in the near future, but with lots of difficulties, because IoTs are the most vulnerable devices so far. States have started working recently on, like, after 2018's attack, Mirai botnets attack. Now states have actually started working on these devices. Later part discusses that how IoTs can benefit from 5G technology in many areas. For example, the concept of smart homes, just like smart cities, industrial IoTs, smart farming, healthcare, autonomous driving in future, future is here. So this is a brief introduction of what is 5G. So there are some notable differences between 4G and 5G. And I have a chart, and I'll show you at the end of the discussion with my PPTs with few pictures in it, that there are like few differences in deployments, bandwidth, technology, core networking, application, and with some advantages, of course, because later part will cover the disadvantages. It's better to highlight few of the advantages. 4G was deployed in the years 2000 and 2000, in between 2000 and 2010. And 5G is the invention that took place after 2014 to 15, and then actually came into being on since 2017. The bandwidth, again, there are different views of different people on the bandwidth, but some say it's like 4G has the bandwidth of more than 100 megabytes per second or 200 megabytes per second, and 5G covers more than 1 gigabytes of gigabytes per second. And in technological terms, they are dynamic information accessible variable devices. And when it comes to 5G, it's dynamic information access, variable devices with AI capabilities. Now this AI thing is creating a whole lot difference between 4G and 5G. And it's there won't be any doubts in saying that 5G is way beyond 4G in many aspects. And then core networks. Internet is a core network. Internet was the core network in 4G and is the same in the 5G, but with different bandwidths and different technologies and et cetera. And the application of 4G is limited to high-speed applications, mobile TVs, and wearable devices. Whereas in 5G case, high-resolution video streaming, remote control of vehicles, robots, and medical procedure, etc., are actually included in the applications. And one of the advantage of 4G was it was high speed handoff global mobility, and in 5G it's extremely high speed with low latency. So coming to the other part of the discussion, where we will jump towards the security concerns of 5G. Fifth generation cybersecurity needs some significant improvements to avoid growing risks of hacking. Some of the security worries result from the network itself, while others involve the devices connecting to 5G, but both aspects put consumers, governments, and businesses at risks. When it comes to 5G and cybersecurity, here are a few of the main concerns. Decentralized security. Pre-5G networks had less hardware traffic points of contact, which made it easier to do security checks and upkeeps. 5G's dynamic software-based systems have far more traffic routing points to be completely secure. All of these need to be monitored. Since this might prove difficult, any unsecured areas might compromise other parts of the network. And the other concern is related to the bandwidth itself. The more the bandwidth, the more the security monitoring concerns. While existing networks are limited in speed and capacity, this has helped providers monitor security in real time. So the benefits of an expanded 5G network might hurt cybersecurity. The added speed and volume will change security teams to create new methods for stopping threats. The other concern is many IoT devices, as I've already explained, many IoT devices are manufactured with lack of security. Not all manufacturers are prioritizing cybersecurity as seen with many low-end smart devices. 5G means more utility and potential for IoT. As more devices are encouraged to connect billions of devices with varied security means billions of possible breach points. Smart TVs, door locks, refrigerators, speakers, and even minor devices like a thermometer for a fish tank can be a network weakness. A lack of security standards for IoT devices mean network breaches and hacking might run rampant. Then, lack of encryption early in the connection process reveals devices information that can be used for device-specific IoT targeted attacks. This information helps hackers know what devices are connected to the network. Details such as operating system and device type, smartphone, vehicle, modem, etc., can help hackers plan their attacks with more precision. Cybersecurity vulnerabilities can take form in a wide variety of attacks. Some of the known cyber threats include botnet attacks, and distributed denial of service attacks, man-in-the-middle attacks, location tracking, and call interception. And there are many other vulnerabilities to the 5G networks. And why 5G cyber threats are a little different from those of the actual cyber threats or maybe cyber attacks is, again, the inclusion of AI in it. And for that purpose, what we need to do is we need to have strong security measures. Like for AI-based cyber attack, I always use this statement, and I think cybersecurity practitioners would kill me one day of using this for no reason, might be that AI-based cyber attacks require AI-based, AI-generated cyber defense. And this cyber defense, where we all are lacking, even America, just in like 2 months back or 1 month ago, they actually initiated a cyber defense policy to secure this. And surprisingly, Pakistan has also given its first cybersecurity policy of 2021 in July. And that was a great start for us too. But we need to do a lot of work because like China and America and Russia too, they are the developed states. They are the most vulnerable ones. We are not that developed and we are not so much dependent on this internet. Like networks of networks. And even if we are, there is a lack of cybersecurity culture here. And not just here, there are many other states too who actually are careless in proposing good laws and good governing policies, whether it's the MNCs or the businesses or any state-to-state interaction. And the main issue of defining critical infrastructure by every state, especially Pakistan, defines its goals. And for states like America and China and Russia and UK and most of the European states, I would say, they have actually taken care of all their critical infrastructure. Like in the they have taken everything in the consideration that they have to protect, either hospitals, either the banking industry, either their any sort of thing that is and that they are dependent on and that might affect their war times or even peace times. Those points are critical to them. So when they are the most vulnerable ones and they are actually acing for this cyber supremacy and this 5G technology supremacy, where this political warfare is a hot topic since 2020, where America actually put sanctions on China's Huawei, and it's one of the giant tech giant. And when, because of America, Europe also had to abandon China in a way where they were not happy. But one thing that I liked more about European response was they have control. They want and they actually prefer control. And they have that sense to have technological supremacy in this 5G domain and in any technological domain. And they consider it as a sovereign matter. They don't want to spread it like fire, and they don't want to entirely be dependent on America or China or Russia. They are actually moving ahead of that. They are developing their own things. And in 5G too, there are certain things, certain parts that they want to establish on their own, develop on their own and deploy on their own. They don't want to be dependent. So this will take a lot more time for Pakistan to actually cope up with all that stuff, apart from the China brotherhood and then India's factor. I think it's a long way for Pakistan to cater all these things, even though it is decided that in the coming years, like 2020 and 2023, they are going to ace up this 5G technology. But they need to take care of the various aspects of how 5G is more vulnerable to in many aspects, and I have discussed most of them. Later going moving on towards some of the recommendations, maybe the future of 5G and cybersecurity, and to stave off widespread weaknesses in national mobile networks, technology developers will have to be extra attentive to 5G security, and 5G security foundations are needed in networks first. Network providers will begin focusing on software protections to cover the unique risks of 5G. They will need to collaborate with cybersecurity firms to develop encryption solutions, network monitoring, and more. And then manufacturers need an incentive to up their security efforts. Consumer education on IoT cybersecurity is necessary. And this calls for how should we prepare for 5G? And for that matter, I would say 5G is a bit further away than the buzz may you have believed. But you will still need to be prepared, even though rollout will take a long time to be truly significant. Some areas have seen upgrades start to pop up. Be sure to take security and privacy into your own hands as much as possible. And for that purpose, we need to install an antivirus solution on all our devices, use a VPN, and it's too much basic. And we need to actually cater all these things. And then practice strong password security, update the default backend passwords on all your IoT devices, keep all your IoT devices updated with security patches. And with this, I would come to the major part of the conversation where I have to discuss the disadvantages of 5G. And the first disadvantage is obstructions can impact connectivity. Already discussed, but we'll discuss it a little more. The range of 5G connectivity is not great, as the frequency waves are only able to travel a short distance. Added to this setback is the fact that 5G frequency is interrupted by physical obstructions, already told you, by trees, towers, buildings, walls. The obstructions will either block, disrupt or absorb the high frequency signals. To counter this setback, the telecom industry is extending existing cell towers to increase the broadcast distance. Then, initial costs for rollout are high. The major challenge that we all, not just Pakistan, everyone is going to face is the cost, because for that, we need the infrastructure required for 5G, and that is expensive. And in rural areas, especially, it's a great deal because in the developing countries where the economy and all these things are already at the dead end, these things are actually a little costly, not little costly, way more costly than we have expected. So more funding and more alliances and more work needs to be done. And again, I've already discussed the rural access, there's a limitation, and then battery drain on devices, upload speeds don't match download speeds, and then detracting from the aesthetics. The erection of more cell phone towers or extension of existing cell phone towers is not welcomed by most communities because they are seen to diminish the overall look and feel of an area. With 5G, there is going to be a need for increased infrastructure development, which won't necessarily be seen as a good thing for local residents. It requires skilled engineers to install and maintain 5G network. Moreover, 5G equipments are costly. This increases cost of 5G deployment and maintenance phases. 5G smartphones are also costly. Hence, it will take some time for the common man to make use of 5G technology. The technology is still under development, and will take time before it is fully operational without any issues. Coverage distance is up to 2 meters in indoor and 300 meters in outdoor. Can be achieved due to higher losses at high frequencies, such as millimeter waves. 5G millimeter wave suffers from many such losses, like penetration loss, attenuation due to rain, foliage loss, etc. It will take time for security and privacy issues to be resolved fully in 5G networks. Okay. And then Huawei, as always, already discussed, that is urging a cash-strapped South Asian nations to adopt its low-cost 5G technology at the tech group. Moves to fend off US claims that it serves as a proxy for Chinese spying. Just like America did with the European countries and many of the African countries too, to not listen to the Chinese Huawei 5G technology speeches and don't buy their devices and all that. Same is the case with India and Pakistan. But it's good that Pakistan and India, and I have read somewhere that Dhaka will actually, government plans that 5G for Dhaka this year, by the end of this year, will be implemented. And India, a good ally of America, and America good in 5G means India good in 5G. China good in 5G means Pakistan might be good in 5G. So this political warfare in this 5G technology thing is actually ongoing, and it will, I think it will move forward. And there are certain states who are actually beyond, they say that they are beyond 5G, like Norway. They think that they are working at the speed of 8G. So not sure, not confirmed, but their speed is so high that they think that it's 8G and 10G in their states. And here we see that it's like after 5G, it will be a 6G. And till now, there are no much debates on it. This is all that I wanted to share about 5G technology and its pros and cons with the political factor in it. Over to you, Mr. Imran.
Thank you very much for a comprehensive presentation, and it's really educate us about the concept of 5G technology and its challenges. With speedy transmission, that 5G is promising, as you said, is also making our equipments more vulnerable. And a decentralization of security is a concern. I agree with you that Pakistan, in comparison to other developed countries, is less vulnerable since we are not up to date with the modern technologies. But the manipulation of data in case of data theft can be a serious concern for Pakistan, since many of our banking system is online and many other important organizations in Pakistan are going online. So we really need, I agree with you, we really need an effective cyber security and resilience mechanism. Vidyesh, thank you very much. I move to the next speaker. Our next speaker is Mr. Arza Khan. Mr. Arza Khan is an internet governance and cybersecurity expert, having extensive experience in ICT's e-governance project management of globally recognized identity management and social safety net programs. He is also founder of Internet Policy Observatory Pakistan, a leading think tank providing researchers, governments, regulators, operators, multilateral institutions, and development agencies and community organizations with information and analysis required to develop innovative and South-centric policies for modern age cyber technologies. Arzak also served as advisory board member for London-based Global Partner Digital Cybersecurity Capacity Building Program for Global South. With this brief introduction, I hand over the floor to Mr. Arza Khan. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Imran Sardar, for a very generous introduction. And thank you, Mubin Ashraf, for touching some very important aspects about 5G and the security challenges. There's a famous saying, speed without accuracy just gets you somewhere fast that you never intended to go. I think we are heading in the same direction with 5G as well. Yeah. Just for the audience sake, I'll just quickly go through the G generation evolution that has happened in the last 20 years, going to 5G, and then why it's really important for the security challenges, especially in the context of India-Pakistan relationship and globally with the Brick and Road initiative that is happening. So 5G is basically a shortened term that stands for the fifth generation of wireless cellular networks. It's probably good to revisit 1G as well. I think most of you might remember, I do remember that when 1G was made available, it was a voice-only service on an analog network, and service was really fraught and dropped calls and had poor security as well. Then we moved on to the second generation, which brought with it the advent of a digital network, and with it significant improvement was seen in quality, security, and something we all use daily, that was text messaging. Then came the third generation. Some of the regions in Pakistan are still on 3G and 2G. 3G represents basically a technology leapfrog with mobile data that supports for web browsing and video. 4G is the current standard some of us are enjoying today with good throughput performance and helping us use services such as Netflix for video streaming, even enjoy services like this platform we are using, or share a ride like on Uber and Kareem. The first four generation primarily focused on improving mobile data, and 5G to some extent seeks to continue this trend and expand its use for mobile broadband access as well. 5G transmits tons of data over shorter distance than 4G LTE technology can. So this helps speeds and consistency of connection signals even when you are moving. So the network is also able to support more devices due to the use of new signal spectrums in 5G. And 5G is more responsive than 4G with lower latency rates. I think it's really important to emphasize the latency rates and improvement in technology here as well. Since devices can talk to the network faster on 5G, you will get more data quickly with more bits per second able to travel to the network with the new uploads and download speeds. You could be downloading movies in seconds versus what's taking like minutes and hours nowadays. So 5G as a technology also promises data rates of 100 times faster than what we are witnessing on a 4G technology. The primary reason being is the network latency, which under 5G is brought under 1 millisecond, and it can support 1 million devices in a square kilometer, which has an availability of 99.9%. So just to give you a sense what 5G is in terms of technology, that gives you a sense that with IoT, as Mubeen Ashraf discussed as well, we will be having numerous devices connected to the internet for 24/7. So in the first two decades of this century, the co-evolutionary adaptation of cyber threat actors and technology has been akin to an escalatory arms race between cyber offense and a cyber defense. I think the paradigm shifting technology advancement, transparent, unclassified reporting on cyber incidents, and the proliferation of open source hacking tools in context of complex geopolitical dynamics like Pakistan has further has exacerbated the cyber defense challenges. Although integration of practices such as cyber threat modeling, information sharing, and threat hunting into defense strategies have come more common in some of the sectors in recent years, the cyber defense community needs to continue to push the envelope to become more resilient and ideally get ahead of the threats the organization would be facing with the coming of 5G. So given the debates around the deployments of 5G networks and its impact on the overall security landscape, 5G rollouts needs to be recognized as a strategic rather than merely a technological choice. I think some nations are in a position, especially in Europe and in North America, that they can roll out 5G, but they are still making strategic decisions, and we as a nation needs to think about it as well. So many countries like US, they have expressed their concerns of 5G and the potential consequences on cybersecurity, especially with the Chinese communication technology companies like Huawei and ZTE having ties with intelligence services. And again, the China's political and legal environment requires cooperation with intelligence agencies, similar to what we see in the US as well. So the outlook for a future that relies on 5G and other new digital pathways is always going to be cyber defined. And another important challenge that is coming up as well is machine learning. I think machine learning, big data analytics, and sensing technologies that will be supported by 5G network could, as a force multiplier for cyber offenses, that could be used for data poisoning, spoofing, deepfakes, and manipulation, hacking. We have seen digital jamming in recent wars, especially in the Middle East and in Eastern Europe as well. That would be considerably more difficult to detect, especially if an attacker used an advanced persistent threat tools that is being powered by an AI system in a spectrum consistent environment. I think secondly, unlikely that any attack can be successfully detected. I think threat identification at machine learning speed would be virtually impossible with modern technologies and infrastructure. So in short, the key challenge lies not in making more false information or sending debugs or disinformation. I think the challenge would be in learning the techniques that can exacerbate the escalation risks and manipulate the information digital landscape that we all are becoming so hooked on for our daily lives as well. So countries like China, Russia, US, North Korea, they can probably, if they have their geopolitical interests, provoke an escalation caused by malicious third party or state proxy clandestine actions. I think what we are seeing recently in Pakistan and Afghanistan as well, there's a lot of third party malicious activity happening on social media, provoking the citizens of each country against each other, which is just a real time example of what's happening globally in terms of the cybersecurity landscape and in terms of how technology is shaping the future. And before I move on to the Pakistan aspect, I think it's really important to understand the forces in the 5G technology development industry as well. I mean, there's a stringent competition between China and US, and as my colleague mentioned earlier as well, the US government has been very open and vocal about the Chinese companies rushing to 5G and deploying 5G network across Europe, North America, and African countries as well. And I'm just going to share some stats. Since 2015, when this race for 5G started, China has outspent the US by roughly $24 billion in 5G infrastructure. And because of this massive investment, China has already built 12 times more 5G base stations than US has at the moment. So Chinese are way ahead in terms of the deployment of infrastructure just to achieve the digital dominance. And to achieve that digital dominance, the Chinese government or the Chinese think tanks, they are using Huawei and ZTE, their largest telecommunication companies, to do that exactly. So China, from the US perspective, they have been always talking about that China is giving underhand deals to Huawei. And in terms of amounts, they have like $85 billion of subsidies that has been provided to the Chinese telecommunication companies by the Chinese government, so they can increase the deployment of 5G, not just only in China, but also in other countries globally as well. So that gives them an edge in terms of technology and digital dominance. And as of late, I think Huawei is currently operating in more than 170 countries. So just gives you an idea of the footprint on that. And recently, and most notably, United Kingdom has also allowed Huawei to take part in the 5G network in that is going to be built in United Kingdom, with Vodafone, LTE, and British Telecom participating in it. And again, this is a company that was charged with bank fraud. I remember it was obstruction of justice and theft of technology, among many other criminal offenses that were brought by the U.S. Justice Department just years ago. And I also remember very well that the FBI director came on the media as well and commented that Huawei has repeatedly refused to respect the U.S. laws and standard international practices. And with Huawei's presence in the U.K., what we have already witnessing is it's already straining the relationship on two countries, especially in terms of intelligence sharing. So on one hand, we see there's a lot of US dominance in developing infrastructure, but on the other hand, we see the Chinese government building out these networks with spending tens of billions of dollars. So this competition is just the start to build the digital dominance race in the future as well. So just for the audience as well, I'm going to quickly update on a Pentagon initiative. I don't know whether you all are following this. If not, I think if you are interested in cybersecurity and the global information dominance experiments, I think you need to follow Guide 3. Guide 3 basically is the global information dominance experiment that embodies a fundamental change in how the US plans to use information and data to increase decision space. Initially, it was for the tactical and strategic level for the military, but also nowadays they are using it for civilian leadership as well. Earlier in the month, the Global Information Dominance Experiment 3, which was executed earlier in July, was a three synchronized distinct stage. This first stage basically says in Guide 3 is to focus on cost-effective data solutions to increase decision space through earlier indications and warning system. That is to get connected more people to the internet. The stage two evaluates the ability to respond to contested logistics and demonstrated global collaborations. So it gives them the logistic planning, especially when more people are connected, they are sharing more information, the more businesses are going online. So they are able to tap into all these logistics plans and movement as well. And this final stage, which is the most alarming one and the one that I've been following quite keenly, is the use of artificial intelligence capabilities to understand the conflict and understand crisis situations before it's happening. So it's basically a live representations of threats and real world assets that can allow Pentagon and other sister organizations to prepare for new wars and new strategic moves for global dominance. So coming to that, I'll just quickly come to where we are as a country. Pakistan has a large internet base. I think we are increasing at a very rapid pace as well. Our banking systems are all connected. We have few critical infrastructures, especially our missile defense system, the nuclear weapons system, and then we are seeing there's a lot of development happening with strategic organizations like NADRA. There is other e-initiative that embeds Trimble or modernize the government system in the country as well. So on one end, we see that Pakistan is moving towards digitalization, but on the other hand, we see that the incorporated laws to tackle these threats that can come from cyber attacks are not covered in depth or wholeness in our legal legislations as well, compared to our counterparts in India. Recently, the Army Chief General Kamar Bajwa, while addressing a gathering at a national security workshop, also addressed that we need to be prepared for the battlefield in all domains. And he strategically emphasized on the battlefield in the cyberspace. So a coherent and all-compassing response is therefore a need of the hour at a national level. Especially, it needs to integrate the military, civil institution, and most importantly, the private sector to fill the large gaps that exist in our present cyber capacity or capabilities at various levels, which requires leadership from the government. I think what we are witnessing at the moment is that many people are quite unaware of the situation and threats we have at our hands. In comparison, I would just quickly touch base on our Indian counterparts, because what we see is a trio of cyber offensive and cyber defensive capabilities in the region that is being developing. Pakistan is being more dependent upon the Chinese technology. Most of our hardware infrastructure is being developed by Chinese hardwares. Whereas in India, India is more looking at the Israeli version for the cyber security, and they recently visited Israel as well, where the policymaker looked in depth at the Israel's Telpoint training program, which is the first of its kind in the world. So under this program, the Israeli Defense Forces recruit some of the country's most talented and innovative young individuals in physics, mathematics, and computer science. So they bring them on board, they teach them for years, and what we have seen that they have producing experts in research and development on cybersecurity. And we have recently seen with the Pegasus news as well that India have been using Israeli technology for surveilling many countries, people, businesses, and even our prime minister as well. But that needs to be determined till now. And India on a strategic end is better off in Pakistan, because they have already signed 17 bilateral agreements and MOUs to upgrade their cybersecurity infrastructure at national, regional, and international level, whereas Pakistan is behind on that framework. Yeah.
Thank you very much, Arsa Khan, for enlightening us about the global competition in 5G technology, where the United States and the China is on the top, and with efficient infrastructure in the United States, with the prior information, as you said, the United States can better prepare itself and can inflict damage to its enemies. So it's an alarming. So I have a couple of questions for you regarding Pakistan and India. Before I go to that question and answer session, I move to Ms. Mubeen Ashraf. I was just looking your profile, in which you were moderating a session on gender and cyber violence as part of Women in Cybersecurity. So we would be interested to know if you could briefly tell us about this concept. Maybe we can have another webinar on this particular subject in the near future. So briefly, please.
Thank you so much for adding this into the discussion. I've actually written an article on it as well, a magazine that we have just launched with the help of my friend. And it was basically about after my, it was written after the panel discussion. And basically cyber violence is a far more serious concern and is different from, and it has various forms, cyber bullying, cyber harassment, and all these things when get intense, this online harassment gets transforms into physical harassment in like it's a chain. So I agree to what you have said that you need to have another 30 to 40 minutes discussion on this separately, but briefly it's just that with the modernization and the increased digitalization and the dependence of users on technology and internet, what is coming ahead of us is that we're ignoring some of the threats in the form of cyber violence, bullying, harassment, and many others in line. So what we need to do is, there is one thing that I really liked about one state up while I was in a panel discussion back then, that Malaysia has anti-cyber stalking laws. And we just made our cybersecurity policy in July 2021. And you see like these countries are actually, and it's pretty clear that how sensitive users' information is. We have previous incidents where Facebook tried to like fetch or like users tried to use our data, and where Mark Zuckerberg had to be present in the EU Parliament for that reason. And they are actually sensitive about their security and their citizen security. And again, I'm a little bit critical on Pakistan in this aspect. And we are a bit careless, not a bit, we are way more careless in this aspect too, as we are in many other things. So we need to set our priorities straight, and we need to focus more on the countermeasures, how we can actually reduce the cyber, because you have seen, we have all experienced and we have all been through terrific experiences in the past, like women are being raped, children, and children are also suffering from certain sort of things. My point of view is, like it is a report as well that suggests that 1 in 3 women have been a victim of violence or bullying in their lives. But in online world, 1 in 10 face this cyber harassment and cyber violence. So all these things actually connect to one thing, that we need to sensitize these topics and we need to talk more and we need to create awareness so that we can actually work on the betterment of ourselves and others too. It's not just the women who are the victims of cyber violence, it's the men as well. So we need have such policies that may include, and that must not be gender specific. It must be it must not be gender biased. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Mr. Arzu Khan, a recent report I was just reading yesterday by the International Institute for Strategic Studies that assesses and ranks the cyber capabilities of 15 different countries, where India stands at 9. And despite its low ranking, which I think much better with its comparison to developed countries like America, Australia, Japan, Canada, Israel, China, and others, India scored better in cybersecurity and resilience. The report finds a vigilant private sector in cybersecurity matters, but the government approach was assessed as fragmented. So my question is about Pakistan. Although country is far behind in that competition, but our private sector is very, very active, like India. I just wanted to know how best Pakistan can utilize the private sector's energy in achieving cybersecurity and resilience. What is the status of the government and private partnership in that domain in Pakistan?
Thank you, Imran Saab. It's an excellent question, and I think it would be worth it to share the link of the report with the audience as well. Just to give you a quick background on how this report was researched, there's a think tank based in London, the International Institute for Strategic Studies, and they have tried to fill this gap with an innovative study, which was released earlier this month. So this is a result of like a 2 years research to assess the cyber capabilities and national power as a net gauge assessment for 15 countries. Unfortunately, Pakistan was not featured in the assessment, but our neighboring country, India, was along with other countries. So what makes the ISS report different from previous index-based measurements of national cybersecurity capacities or capabilities is it's a more comprehensive qualitative analysis of a country's wide cyber ecosystem. It also includes its interaction with international security, economic competition, there is military affairs, and the countries are judged on 7 different criteria. So just to quickly update you, the criteria was strategy, and there's governance, command and control, then there is core cyber intelligence capability, cyber empowerment and dependency, and then cyber security and resilience. Apart from all the countries, US was the only country that leads the world in strength in all categories. An unrivaled partnership between business, government, and universities were singled out as an important advantage that US possesses over the rest of the world. And in the second tier of this report, these countries include China, Russia, UK, France, Canada, Israel, and Australia. And in the third tier, where India is, these countries are in early stages of their cyber power development, and they don't have strength in all these categories. They have their strengths and potential strengths in some categories and have significant weaknesses in other. And India has, despite its geostrategic importance and instability as well, is keenly aware of the cyber threats it faces and is quickly developing a modest program for policy doctrine on cyber safe security. There is a lot of institutional reforms happening in cyber governance, but what we have seen and whatever news that comes out of India, I think it's slow and incremental compared to Pakistan. And again, India is a big country. If you look at the internet penetration rate, India has 45% penetration rate. The urban population in India has 67% penetration rate. That means with the coming of 5G IoT services, millions of devices would be connected in cities like Mumbai, Delhi, and others. So imagine the threats and opportunities it presents in terms of cyber security, cyber capacity, and cyber development. Whereas Pakistan, I mean, Pakistan need to jump in the right direction, I think, in terms of developing its cyber capacity and capability. At the moment, apart from the Ministry of Defense, I don't see any other ministry taking a lead on this. I think it's really important that we as a nation come together and incorporate this cybersecurity vision into our development vision as well. I mean, with more and more e-businesses developing up with the impact of COVID-19, we saw there was a massive uptake of internet services in the Pakistan. And fortunately, I think we should be thankful to the telecom companies that they were able to plan and implement the strategic backhauls that was needed for the upgrade at such a quick level. But we don't see a coordination from where I'm seeing. I don't see any coordination on the cybersecurity foundation as well. So as we pursue a connected future, I think we must place equivalent, if not a greater focus on security of all those connection devices and applications that we will be connecting to the internet in coming decade. I think it's really important to understand to build a 5G on top of a weak cybersecurity foundation is to build on a sand. I think it will grapple any moment whenever you get hit. So that will just not be a matter of safety of network user that Arzak is using a Zoom device and he can get hacked, or someone is using a Kareem app and he gets hacked. It's not like individual users. I think it will become a matter of national security in the coming years. And we need to be thinking in those lines to be prepared. I think the after the fact cost of missing a proactive cybersecurity opportunity will be much greater than the cost of cyber diligence upfront. But unfortunately, what we have witnessed in terms of our ICT policies, our digital security policies, or our Digital Pakistan initiative, that most of our cyber diligence thinking has not been upfront. We need to be proactive when it comes to the cybersecurity frameworks to secure the larger 5G ecosystem that we are planning to build upon.
Thank you very much, Arzak Khan. The floor is open for the question and answer session. I have many questions in the chat panel, and I begin with the question from Mr. Ammar Farooq, who is a cybersecurity researcher at the Institute of Regional Studies. Ammar is asking about the steps. What steps the Pakistan should take to counter the emerging cyber threats, keeping in view and the deployment of 5G technology in Pakistan? So I would like to both panelists to please comment on this.
I think when you talk about stats, if I'm correct, I mean, when it comes to cyber security or cyber espionage or cyber capacity, you don't get much of these stats globally. I think what gets published would roughly be 2% of what's happening in the industry. Partly because if you would have followed Edward Snowden, he back in 2013 highlighted that Pakistan was one of the top countries that gets surveilled by international Five Eyes forces or the US. Or there are lots of agencies that are surveilling each and everything we do online for their own intelligence purposes. I mean, such leaks do not make stats. Cyber espionage or cyber threats that are emerging or that gets reported are the ones that we detect. And what we have witnessed that with NSA, the NSA and Edward Snowden leaks, I mean, majority of the countries, majority of the internet experts, majority of the cybersecurity experts were shocked at the disclosures of Edward Snowden and how this international racketing of cyber espionage was happening rampantly across the globe and without anyone knowing. So they would be sitting in their offices in Virginia and would be able to tap a mobile phone tower or a cell site in Ahmedabad. So that gives you a sense of their penetration into the network. But you don't get stats for that because we are yet to develop the cyber defense capacity to understand these threats. And once you understand these threats, you would be only able to get the stats out of this. But globally, and in speaking of the private sector, I can talk about a few of the organizations that I've worked with. The threats are increasing at an alarming level. And one of the major challenges the government and the private sector in Pakistan is facing is a lack of human resource for cybersecurity. You might be a good IT engineer. There's no doubt you might be a good telecom engineer, but understanding the cyber landscape in terms of security espionage is different. And you need to have specialized courses and interest to develop the skills that are needed for this industry.
Thank you. Ms. Mubinisha, would you like to add some?
Yes, sure, I would. My take on this question is when we talk about cyber threats in general, and particularly in Pakistan's context, Mr. Azhar Khan has explained it in a great manner, that Edward Snowden's leaks were the most horrifying in its own way. And surprisingly, my MPhil thesis was also on, like, similar to this Edward Snowden thing, and it was on cyber weapons, actually. And the main contention and the point that I addressed in my thesis, in my MPhil, during my MPhil degree, was that cyber offense has an upper hand over cyber defense. And this security, this is creating a security dilemma in this South Asian region. One state having good capabilities, you don't know about them. We cannot disclose cyber capabilities with any other state, even if it is China to Pakistan or America to Israel or America to India. These capabilities are actually hidden. Once out in the wild, anybody can test it. Anybody can take anything out of it. Like, when the code is reverse engineered, there are many chances that cyber terrorists, hacktivists, many other groups, they'll take advantage of that. And we have plenty of examples in that case. When it comes to the cybersecurity measures in particular reference to 5G, when we talk about cyber threats, 5G is no less of, like, it's no less of an issue. And same point I'll discuss in this context is that the internet speed is high, bandwidth, everything is so high that, and with all the things good and high, there are extreme chances that we have high level threats. For that, we need AI for AI. AI for AI offense, we need AI defense. And it's not just our problem, it's the worldwide problem that for unknown threats, antiviruses don't work. Right, and these sophisticated capabilities are actually owned by states. I can say that in front of anyone. If people disagree, I'd say that yes, it's a state-owned capability that and states actually use it on other states for economic warfare, for political warfare, for many things. But possible suggestions would be cyber deterrence, cyber diplomacy, civil military cooperation in that domain, because Pakistan, you have already discussed about, and my other colleague has already discussed about, the critical infrastructure that Pakistan is focused on. We have nuclear facilities, we have many other things like military dominant stuff, and work is being done in those spheres. But what we need to do is we need to connect the military and civilian together, and we need to start working on the betterment, whether it's 5G or general cyber attacks. So I hope that I have answered the question.
Thank you very much. We have more questions in the chat panels. One question is from Abdul Hussain. He was talking about, as the things going on very quick, change in cyber security, how you deal without policy. Pakistan is going to make any policy. I just wanted to add this, Pakistan is already having a policy, I think back it was drafted in 2021, I think, and it's implemented. But still Pakistan does not have any cyber security doctrine, which really need. I go to another question that, what is the impact the 5G we have on backhaul networks? I don't know what is this. It's a technical term. And how do the security risk of 5G compare to those presented by 3G and 4G? What can be the risk factors? These two questions is from Saad Rasool. So over to Arza Khan and Ms. Mubeen Ashraf.
Thank you, Saad. Excellent questions. Really excellent questions. I think the primary impact on backhaul network would be increasing their capacity. I think as one 5G end user can generate up to 10 times more bandwidth compared to what we have on a 4G end user. So in a layman's term, I think when you have a 5G smartphone, you will be using more capacity, you'll be downloading more data. That would put pressure on the backhaul. So the backhaul network needs to be increased. And I think Ministry of IT has chaired some meeting on increasing Pakistan backhaul in terms of developing the core network for 5G as well. I'm not sure because I'm not aware of the further details that came out, but I think to prepare for 5G, the backhaul networks need to be enhanced to cater the capacity. I think in some cities it won't be an issue, but providing connectivity to most of Pakistan, they would require a backhaul increase as well. And the second question was, how do the security risks of 5G compare to those presented by 3G and 4G? As I mentioned earlier, I think the security risk in 5G would be more comparatively to 3G and 4G. It's because you will be connected more. The internet speeds would be good. I think hacking someone on a 1G network would be particularly difficult for anyone compared to a 5G network because of the speed and latency issues. So as more and more devices get connected, your TV is connected, we are seeing modern refrigerators are smart and they are connected to the internet as well. So they all present an opportunity for hackers and non-state actors or even for states to exploit the software is built in and it can exacerbate the risk as well. I think with 5G, you will see a greater increase in risk in terms of hacking and leakage of data as well. So it's really important that we have strategies in place. And then once we have the strategies, it's really important to have the action plans in place as well. Unfortunately, with Pakistan, what we have seen for the past 72 years, there's a lot of good policies as well. There's a lot of good strategies, but nothing gets implemented. There's no action plan to follow up. The Millennium Development Goals is one such as well. The 2020 plan would be what we had previously, 2015 plan, and then we had the 2025 vision for developing Pakistan. But I have not seen any action plan to achieve those goals. And that's the same with 5G as well. I think you need to have an action plan on how you plan to secure the end user, the infrastructures, most importantly, the businesses as well. I think Pakistan has exported like $2 billion of software export globally. But it's really important to understand if you are doing business in Europe, there is GDPR and you need to be in compliance. If you're not in compliance, you are risking of going bankrupt for providing services, softwares, or IT solutions to companies or organizations in Europe. So it's really important that we develop and build in those practices and avoid the risks that exist. I hope this answers the question.
Thank you very much, Afzal Khan. I agree with you that we are very good at making policies, but at the implementation level, we are lagging. And I would rather stress that instead of action plan, we need actionable plan. Means we really need to work on what is achievable and what is not. So second question from Taiba Khushim. I would like Mubin Ashraf to please respond to that question. I just read this question. In view of availability of 5G and fast access to social media, how you see misuse of social media for online extremism and radicalization and how to counter these risks? Please.
Thank you so much for this wonderful question. It's one of my favorite topics to talk on because cyber weapon social media as a cyber weapon or used by states or social media is used as a weapon by cyber terrorists. It's one of the most interesting things to study about. And I would answer this question in few sentences. Social media, yes, is for a long time is being used for online extremism and radicalization. And with 5G, if 5G comes into place in the near future, now we have just 4G and we had 3G, 3Gs, and we have seen drastic number of incidents that were actually carried through social media. We have ISIS recruitment of terrorists through social media. We have the women terrorist wings running on the social media platforms. We have states like Russia manipulating the US election through social media, and this and there are plenty of softwares. To your surprise, there are plenty of softwares that are actually used to do carry out these activities, and it's a whole long process. So yes, if it comes to place, more speed, more vulnerable, more distance, more breaches. This is all interlinked. We cannot escape from them. So we need to have a strict check and balance on this. And how can we counter these risks, like regarding social media? Social media, like we, first of all, we need to open our eyes while using social media. We should be careful who we are adding. We should be careful who we are talking to. We should be careful with whom we are trusting sharing our passwords with. It's pretty normal that we share our passwords with our friends, and these accounts are logged in from many devices. Some devices get lost, and these hackers, they try new things. And with India and Pakistan rivalry in place, and this Kashmir issue, we have seen after Pulwama how social media was drastically used not for radicalization purposes, obviously, but was restricted and was used by state-sponsored channels. So this social media has a wide range and wide users. So we need to be careful before using, before uploading, before trusting, EU Disinformation Lab. We have that example in place. There is plenty of misinformation and disinformation shared on social media sites. So please be careful, and until or unless we have a secure cybersecurity policy with regards to all social media measures in place, first, we need to be careful ourselves. So this is what I have to say about this.
Thank you very much, Mr. Arzakhan. Would you like to respond to this question? How to counter the radicalization in social media? Ms. Mubeen Ashraf highlighted this question or this answer to this question from a user end. So what the state can do in this perspective?
I think the state can follow what has been practiced in Europe and US as well post 9/11. I think what we see, there was a lot of education, especially starting from primary schools, on how to safely use technology. I think Pakistan needs to do that as well. At the moment, we do not have any social media curriculum or safe security practices being taught in school level. And that's one of the reasons that we see there's a growing extremism, because extremists can use these networks. I mean, there's so many networks. There's Facebook, Twitter, you just go on, the list goes on and on and on. But what we need is awareness on whom to trust online and what information do you want to put online. I mean, there has been recent incidents of kidnapping as well, where people were following individuals on social media, because what we have seen in Pakistan, there's a habit of putting everything online. If you are having a cup of tea somewhere, people go online and check in, and it's made public. When you make anything public, it's for everyone's consumption. It's for your friend's consumption. It might be for your crush consumption, or maybe for an ex, but it's also for people and bad actors and non-state actors as well. So you need to be really mindful of what you put on social media. What we have seen is a growing misuse of social media as well in Pakistan. I mean, the number of cases that get reported to cybercrime, especially for harassment, sexual harassment, or radicalization in terms of exploitation or human trafficking is just amazing. And it just gives you a sense that the threat is out there and we are not prepared for it. I think what would be the best thing to do is start preparing from home. I mean, if you have kids, start educating them, because most of the families that I know and I've seen are using smartphones as a pacifier for kids. It's very risky, and it exposes your young child to numerous threats. And it also damages the brain in terms of exposure to content that you would not be exposing your child to. So I think we need to be mindful of the impact it has and start talking and debating about it in our social circles. I think at the moment, the cybersecurity or the radicalization or the social issues that we are witnessing because of technology are just part of webinars and conferences. I think we need to have these discussions at home on your dinner table or having breakfast with your kids or going out with your friends and then share and discuss the issues as well. So people are aware of the challenges. I think at the moment, there is a digital divide in awareness as well. The elite class, they have some awareness because of the issues they have faced, whereas the other class, I mean, they have no awareness. People who are getting connected to the smartphone for the first time, they have no awareness around the use of or the safe policies or how this data is being used and how this data will remain there for generations. I mean, this data will not be going away if you close your account on Facebook or Twitter. It's going to stay there for a century or probably more.
Thank you very much, Mr. Azhar Khan. This is a dilemma that when the government starts to penetrate to stop the misuse of social media, and there is so much hue and cry and the criticism from the global global level that it's against the freedom of expression. So we are really facing the challenges of these two things. So I just ask one last question and then I wrap up the session. I would like Mr. Azhar Khan to please respond to that question because you have expertise in particular domain that I just asked. Although India has many progress, why I'm quoting again and again India, because at this Institute of Regional Studies is basically study India in depth. And in cybersecurity, we also look for Indian perspective and its doctrine, like its nuclear doctrine, Cold Star doctrine. And we also extensively look into the cybersecurity perspective of India. So how it is going to impact Pakistan. That is why we usually ask the question about India. So India has made progress in cybersecurity infrastructure, but it is constantly besieged by attack from rivals and adversaries. 1.16 million cyber attacks in 2020 alone were reported in India. Hackers have targeted India's critical infrastructure installations like the nuclear plant and its electric grids. So one of the main reasons assessed was India's heavily reliance on imported equipment. I just wanted to ask if India, having a global fame in cybersecurity and resilience, is vulnerable to many cyber attacks. How can Pakistan secure its digital borders? Since Pakistan, like India, is a nuclear country and also rely on imported hardware. Don't you think Pakistan's cybersecurity doctrine is a need of R to document all the challenges and the way forward? Please.
Thank you, Imran Saab. I think it's a very important question, especially in terms of our regional placing and why India is getting more attacked. I think when you look at the penetration levels, India is more connected than Pakistan. And one of the reasons is that India exports more than $100 billion of software and technology to the European and North American countries compared to $2 billion in Pakistan. So that gives you the sense of the gap we have in terms of IT as a policy. I think India, like Pakistan, is dependent upon foreign hardware. Initially, when networks were being rolled out, when PTCL was upgrading and infrastructure, we had mostly Canadian and European infrastructure. But with the passage of time and the considerable cost that goes into investing into development of these networks, we have become more reliant on the Chinese partners, which is ZTE, Huawei. So most of our telecom infrastructure or critical infrastructure is being developed upon ZTE and Huawei. I think Pakistan needs to immediately sign an MOU with China for their digital security protection. I think when you are using equipment infrastructure that most of the North American countries are tapping in for their own information sharing and dominance, especially when it comes to global powers, it's really important that Pakistan needs to be prepared. Similarly, India is facing a lot of hacks that get reported. Again, there's a lot of hacks that don't get reported. There's a lot of surveillance that never makes it to the media. There's a lot of non-state third-party activities that never get detected. I think with 1.66 million attacks, I'm still think it's a bit less from what they have reported. I think if you look at the actual numbers, that would be far, far more greater. But India is closely working with a main cyber intelligence agency. I think the National Technical Research Organization, it relies a lot on regional partners. I think with one of the major partners where they have signed an MOU as well as United States for wider insights. I think it's providing them a culture where they are able to tap into the resources the US is providing them. So Pakistan does not have that. Even though we were partners in the war on terror, we never got access to the digital technologies and tools that the US government has been using for more than two decades. I think it gives you an idea on how naive we were in terms of cybersecurity or using cyber as a mechanism for further developing our cyber strategy and offensive capability. Pakistan is mostly dependent on China at the moment, but I'm not even sure that China is providing them the same tools and technologies that they are using themselves. So Pakistan needs to look at their own private sector businesses. They need to provide them subsidies. They need to incentivize cybersecurity as a business. I think the reason why US dominates today globally in terms of cybersecurity is primarily because of the fact that the private sector in the US has been a major contributor to developing cyber technologies, whether offensive or defensive. And they have contributed billions of dollars in terms of reaching out to new technology, developing new softwares, infrastructures. And what we see is their dominance globally as well is because of that relationship. Secondly, the US government has been closely working with research institutes, academia. Unfortunately, I'm not seeing that happening in Pakistan. I mean, the government is working in isolation on one end. The academia, I mean, there's very little money that has been put into these research institutes. There is very little incentive for researchers in Pakistan to work on cybersecurity. I think you need to incentivize that. I mean, you need to incentivize private businesses in terms of seed funding, providing them seed funding. I see a lot of talent in universities that I go to, but unfortunately, there is very little opportunity for them in terms of contributing to the cybersecurity landscape is because of the lack of opportunities and funding that is available. And for the private sector, I think it's time that they start building and investing in cybersecurity as well and develop platforms and relationships that involves the civil society organization, the government, the academia, and the private sector. I think that's the model the US adopted decades ago, and that's the model that we need to adopt as well. If anyone is thinking that they would be compelling or understanding or overcoming these challenges that would be coming our way in the next decade alone is living in a fool's paradise. I think for this, we need to develop a coalition on cybersecurity. We need to have a regional collaboration with other countries as well. And Pakistan needs to start focusing on digital diplomacy. I think we don't have a school that teaches digital diplomacy in the modern age. So that gives you an idea that where we are in terms of our cyber strategy or cyber policy. Whereas if you go to the US or Europe, they have schools where they teach diplomats on cybersecurity and digital diplomacy, which is really important. Even last week, I was following a tweet on Twitter where the Israeli foreign ministry was giving digital diplomacy classes to the new inductees, just to give them a brief sense on what we are facing and how we need to develop relationship with other global powers and countries. And unfortunately, I have not seen that at the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, nor the federal foreign minister has taken any initiative on that. I think we need to start discussing digital diplomacy. I think digital Pakistan would materialize when we have all these essence in it.
Thank you very much, Zafan. You have raised very good suggestions in which the digital diplomacy you stress is really important, in the sense that Pakistan is heavily relying on imported equipments. And in that sense, as you mentioned, that MOU between China and Pakistan over the cybersecurity, do you think there is any kind of realization at the governmental level about this concept, or about to have any kind of MOU with China and Pakistan over this?
Unfortunately, no. I think I don't want to hit the BRI CPEC initiative hard, but we are planning to build a digital highway with China without having any oversight on the national sovereignty and integrity. I think that's what I have mentioned in my book as well, which is soon to be published. The next security threat to Pakistan is not from India. I think it's coming in the terms of digital technology. And we need to have discussions with China as well. I think Chinese are very cunning people. They would never highlight your weaknesses. They would exploit your weaknesses.
Thank you very much, Arzah Khan. I hope one day we will have a common understanding between China and Pakistan, since China is our friend for many decades, and our friendship is very strong enough that we can understand. I have realized, and everyone is agree with me, that Pakistan and China friendship is based on common understanding of each other's security sensitivities. So in that sense, I don't see any major threat in the near future in terms of cyber attacks or anything else. But now I move to wrap up this session. I would just ask Ms. Naveen Ashraf for any last comment, then I wrap up. Kindly unmute.
Sorry. Before we move into any technological advancements, I think that we first study and be critical of what are the pros and cons of a particular thing. And before addressing the previous threats, I don't think that it's wise enough to jump into certain things that are way more riskier than the previous ones. So first we need to have certain policies in place, because they have their own importance, because they provide guidance, consistency, accountability, and it's a good framework. So first we need to be clear ourselves, like the government first, and then the citizens will be. So lots of advantages, but even more disadvantages to 5G technology. So I think it's better that we cater all these things, and the link between civilians and military, and the government and the academicians, it must be strong enough to do all that stuff.
Thank you very much. In the end, I would like to thank Mr. Arzah Khan and Ms. Naveen Ashraf for educating us about the potential benefits of 5G technology, and also apprising the participants about the foreseeable challenges that Pakistan could face at the domestic, regional, and international level. So with this, I thank once again all the panelists and participants, and would be looking forward for your participation in the next webinar, probably in the first week of September, on the same subject with little different title. Thank you, and Allah Hafiz.